an updated and expanded message from Muad'Dib about the 7th of July 2005.
Dear viewer, I hope this finds you well, in good spirit, and having a good day. Regarding the 7/7/2005 terrorist attacks in London, let us look at the facts and see what we were told and compare them. Then, using Occam's razor and common sense, let us see what conclusions are to be drawn, so we can all understand what most likely really did happen that day. First chapter, title, Mock Exercises and Bomb Hoaxes in the Run-Up to 7/7/2005. More than a year before the 7/7/2005 attacks, on the 16th of May 2004, an edition of the BBC One Panorama programme broadcasted a mock exercise imagining what would happen if a terrorist attack was executed in London in the near future, consisting of three explosions on tube trains in the London Underground and one explosion on a road vehicle. The following excerpt from the BBC programme gives us a good idea of why this programme was made.
If there are now bombs going off above ground, in this case a lorry being attacked, it could happen anywhere. So the potential for mass panic across not just the capital but the whole country is very much with us. I think therefore we need to look at more serious measures. We do have reserve powers in effect to take over the BBC if we were to wish to, and to get them to broadcast whatever we wanted them to broadcast. Those powers are there in the Broadcasting Act. My advice to the Prime Minister would be not to use those, but I think we should be talking to the broadcasters about having the Prime Minister on the air very quickly.
You wouldn't disagree with that, Michael, at all?
No, I entirely agree that the Prime Minister should be out there, and we shouldn't be using the powers to bring in the BBC, but we should certainly be talking to the broadcasters about the way in which the coverage is going to be organised.
Please note well that he said the coverage is going to be organised. In other words, he was saying that they would write the script for and then edit and control the media coverage of an event in which there were three explosions on London tube trains and one on a road vehicle, if such an event were to take place in the near future. The question that begs to be asked is this: was that what they were actually in the process of planning, and precisely the reason for that programme?
This is the kind of terrorist attack the government repeatedly says is going to happen.
We've been absolutely clear, we can't guarantee that there will never be an attack. It's quite likely that they're planning one now.
I am wondering about the purpose and effect of this very programme.
This BBC Panorama programme appears to have been used by those behind the 7/7/2005 attack as the means by which the media's response to the attack in the near future was studied, so it could be controlled and directed towards their own ends. Mr. Price plays the bad cop and issues the threat of taking over control of the BBC, and then Mr. Portillo plays the good cop and says that there is no need to do that as long as the BBC behaves itself and broadcasts whatever they want them to. The good cop, bad cop scenario is just theatre, to deceive the viewer. The reality is that the BBC is a government propaganda machine and is already, and always has been, controlled and used by the government.
The headlines at 9 o'clock. In the past hour, there have been three major explosions on the London Underground. The first occurred at 10 past 8 on the Piccadilly line between Knightsbridge and Hyde Park Corner. The second at 16 minutes past 8 on the Central line between Tottenham Court Road and Oxford Circus. And the third at 27 minutes past 8 as a train was arriving at Vauxhall Station from Stockwell on the Victoria line. Emergency services have been called to all three scenes. There are no reports available yet on the number of casualties, and the police have said that it's too early to identify a possible cause. London Underground is now closed, and the police are asking people not to travel.
350,000 people alone are making their way towards the city of London at this point. And if the access overload system has been triggered and they can't get onto the mobile telephones, this will have profound indications for them, the next of kin.
We can now confirm that a tanker carrying chlorine has exploded at the junction of Shoreditch High Street and Commercial Street. Chlorine is extremely toxic in this form, and the police are issuing express warnings to people to stay indoors, close windows, and remain there until the all clear is given.
In the days leading up to 7/7/2005, there were hoax bomb scares in Nottingham and Sheffield.
There will be more about Sheffield and South Yorkshire Police, whose headquarters are in Sheffield, later in this video.
Were these false alarm hoaxes meant not only to cause panic and confusion, but also to lull everyone into a false sense of security, and into thinking that the initial reports in London on 7/7/2005 would also be false alarm hoaxes, so people would ignore them until it was too late? Second chapter title. Peter Power, dupe or accomplice? Then, on 7/7/2005, we were told on TV by Peter Power of Visor Consultants that they and the private company employing them, who helped choose the scenario for it, were running a mock terrorist drill in the London Underground, with practically the same scenario as what actually really happened on that day. In other words, the actual mock anti-terror drill that the BBC Panorama programme of May 2004 had outlined had been chosen by Visor's client to be carried out on the very same day that four Muslim suicide bombers also chose the same scenarios that Visor's client had chosen for the mock drill, causing real and devastating explosions on three London tube trains and one road vehicle. Please think about that unbelievable set of coincidences for a few seconds, to let the implications of it sink in. Then, please ask yourself, what are the odds against all of that happening by chance?
Just to get this right, you were actually working today on an exercise that envisioned virtually this scenario?
Almost precisely. I was up until 2 o'clock this morning because it's our job, my own company, Visor Consultants. We specialise in helping people to get their crisis management response. How do you jump from slow time thinking to quick time doing? And we chose a scenario with their assistance, which is based on a terrorist attack because they're very close to a property occupied by Jewish businessmen. They're in the city, and there are more American banks in the city than there are in the whole of New York. A logical thing to do. And
how extraordinary today must feel for you as it unfolds.
In his TV video clip, Peter Power states that their customer helped to choose the exact scenario. I repeat, Visor's customer helped to choose the exact scenario. To this day, Peter Power refuses to publicly identify the customer who chose the exact scenario. Why?
Since then, he has claimed that it was for London-based information giant Reed Elsevier, which, interestingly, has links to the arms trade, the military-industrial complex, and Defence Systems and Equipment International. A subsidiary, Spearhead, organised defence shows, including an event where it was reported that cluster bombs and extremely powerful riot control equipment were offered for sale. Reed Elsevier's European head office is in Amsterdam, and so is the Israeli security company, ICTS. I said Peter Power claimed that the company was Reed Elsevier because it doesn't make sense. Why would a publishing company want to run an exercise involving blowing up tube trains? How could that affect a publishing business? Why would a publishing company need to go from slow time thinking to quick time doing just because some tube trains had blown up? It smells fishy and unreal. I, for one, along with many others, do not believe or trust him. In the BBC Conspiracy Files 77, he backtracked and stated that it was entirely office-based, involving six people, whereas initially he said it was for a company involving 1,000 people.
And we sat everybody down in the city, 1,000 people involved in the whole organisation, but the crisis team...
We know from other sources that there was at least one live drill being carried out that day, involving lots of people, including policemen. DCI Steve Williams of South Yorkshire Police, all the way from Sheffield, was there, in London, taking part in a training drill that day. It has also been observed that on Luton Station car park CCTV video footage, both on the day of the practice run, the 28th of June, and later on 7-7, there was a dark-coloured Jaguar present in the Luton Station car park that appears to have been the car of their handler. Did the Jaguar's driver provide them with the backpacks?
Who was driving that Jaguar? Third chapter title, Foreign Security Firms. Can they be trusted? Verint Systems is the security firm that is responsible for the CCTV surveillance cameras in the London Underground rail network, and it is an Israeli company with approximately 1,000 employees. No CCTV footage of the four Muslims boarding the tube trains has been released by Verint, who claim that their cameras were not working. Why? Because the four Muslims were not on the tube trains that blew up. Fourth chapter title. The four Muslims, actors or patsies? We were also told that the training exercise involved 1,000 people and, of course, amongst those 1,000 people would have to be the four people who were recruited to play the parts of the mock terrorists. Therefore, as part of the exercise, they would have recruited four young Muslim men to carry four backpacks that were to contain mock explosive devices. Who were their Muslim recruits? These Muslim men would naturally buy return train tickets and not one-way tickets, because they would be going home after playing their parts in the training exercise. One of them, the oldest, who would be considered the ringleader of the group because of his age, would have been asked to make a suicide video prior to 7-7-2005, being told it would form part of the training mock terrorist exercise in order to make the exercise and possibly a film to be made of it look as realistic as possible. He would obviously not have been told the details of the whole plan until later, probably when he and the others arrived at Luton on the 7th of July 2005, to make absolutely certain that the scenario of the drill which would take place that day could not be talked about by or to anyone. The second oldest would also be asked to make a similar video as a backup for just in case anything went wrong, and or the oldest pulled out of the drill before the 7th of July 2005.
Mohammed Siddiqui Khan's wife Hasina, now his widow, was pregnant and had started bleeding on the 5th of July, 2 days before the bombings took place. There was obviously something wrong with her, so Mohammed Siddiqui Khan took her to hospital in Dewsbury. She was examined and booked in for a scan on the 7th because of a threatened miscarriage. So, in the circumstances, as a loving husband and dad, as he demonstrated in his second video that has been broadcast, he most probably did pull out of the training exercise. After he had taken his wife home, he said he was going to see his friends, and she never saw him again. She miscarried on the 7th of July, the day of the bombings, not knowing what had become of her husband. The petrol attendant at Woodall Services on the M1 motorway, where Shahzad Tanweer stopped for fuel in the Nissan Micra, says he only saw two people in the car, Shahzad Tanweer and Haseeb Hussain, as can be seen in the CCTV footage. So, it is quite possible that Mohammed Siddiqui Khan never made the trip to London, but was grabbed in Leeds and disposed of. Since making 7/7 Ripple Effect, new things have come to light about Mohammed Siddiqui Khan and Shahzad Tanweer and their involvement in Operation Crevice in 2004, during which they were photographed on numerous occasions with the suspects involved in Operation Crevice. However, they were not investigated. Whilst the others were not only investigated, Omar Khayyam, Anthony Garcia, Waheed Mahmoud, Jawad Akbar and Salahuddin Amin were arrested, charged and convicted of terrorist charges. Among the remaining 40 were two men whose names were to become notorious, Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, the alleged ringleader of the July 7 bombers, and his alleged right-hand man, Shahzad Tanweer. Operation Crevice was an investigation into a group of Muslims who are alleged to have been manufacturing ANFO bombs from ammonium nitrate fertilizer and fuel oil in the UK, similar to what Timothy McVeigh used in his Oklahoma City truck bomb in the USA. Mohammed Siddiqui Khan was recorded meeting Khayyam four times in the final stages of Operation Crevice. On one occasion, he even asked Khayyam, "Are you a terrorist?" How could they do that unless Khan was wired up with a microphone and told to ask that question? Who would ask that question if not told to do so, so that the answer could be recorded and used in evidence? Shahzad Tanweer also met Khayyam around this time. Operation Crevice wound up in the spring of 2004, just around the time that the BBC Panorama programme, London Under Attack, was being made and broadcast in May. I and others, including Charles Shoebridge, who is a well-known security expert, have suspected for quite some time that Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, codenamed Ibrahim, according to Mohammed Junaid Babar, and Shahzad Tanweer were in fact MI5 assets, and this Operation Crevice evidence is further indication that they were indeed working for MI5. Charles Shoebridge is a writer, broadcaster and independent authority on issues of security, intelligence, terrorism and crime. A graduate of History and Politics and of the Royal Military Academy Sandhurst, he served for almost two decades until 2000 in diverse frontline policing and military roles, specializing in counter-terrorism and intelligence operations. Prior to his service at Scotland Yard and elsewhere with the Metropolitan Police, he also worked in counter-terrorism as a commissioned officer in the British Army. He has made numerous TV, radio and newspaper contributions, including as one of the host presenters of the critically acclaimed TV series Crisis Command.
Well, with me now in the studio, Charles Shoebridge, former anti-terrorist intelligence officer with the police here in London. Is this a big miss by the authorities?
Well, I think we've already established, actually, in the panoply of information that's emerged since the 7th of July attacks, that suggests that certainly Khan and certainly Tan Wir were known to the security services to varying degrees. That has emerged already, but there's no question that this new information, which I think sounds credible, certainly it's the sort of information that is given to police quite regularly about the activities of Islamic extremists and others of terrorist interest, should have added to that picture. And so once again, we're talking about the intelligence game, if you like, of a jigsaw, in effect, putting together all these disparate elements of information to come up with a profile of a person and assess the risk from that person correctly. That isn't what happened in this case.
Yeah, because we've got what this man says he did, and there's new information just this week from the United States saying that the US tipped off the British authorities about Mohammed Siddiqui Khan anyway, and then there was the original sort of admission, which came quite late, from the security services here, that they were aware of him and that they'd been following him tangential to another investigation. I mean, it does all mount up, it seems, over time, that there was more and more information there.
No, that's right, and I don't think, again, that's a surprise to people who actually worked in the industry, if you like, of intelligence. It was always going to be highly improbable that somebody comes straight out as what the media was calling a clean skin and suddenly becomes a suicide bomber.
Well, the media, led on by briefings from the authorities.
I think that's absolutely right, and there was a good reason for that, I'm sure, which was, from their perspective anyway, which was, of course, if these are clean skins, how can we blame the security services for not having been on their trail? As it's turned out, as I think was predictable and predicted, this has turned out to be not the case. The level of information that was coming in about Khan, particularly if these American reports especially, which now seem to be being backed up by the actual American authorities, not just appearing in an author's book, that they tipped off the British about the specifics of Khan. And this was quite a serious plot in the United States that we were talking about, an attempt to blow up synagogues and so on. The amount of information coming in and the quality of information coming in, the fact that that has been so consistently overlooked, it would appear, by the security service MI5, to me suggests really only one of two options. Either A, we've got a level of incompetence that would be unusual even for the security service, but B, possibly, and this is a possibility, that this man Khan may even have been working as an informant for the security service. It's difficult otherwise to see how it can be that they've so covered his tracks in the interim.
Interesting. Thank you very much.
The only logical explanation for Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, codename Ibrahim, and Shehzad Tan Wir not being investigated as part of Operation Crevice, and asking Omar Khayyam if he was a terrorist so that it could be recorded as evidence, is that they were working for MI5 and were sent to infiltrate the group and report back to MI5. This would give another possible explanation for the origins of the so-called suicide videos of Mohammed Siddiqui Khan and Shehzad Tan Wir, who are reported to have frequently made visits to Pakistan to allegedly visit terrorist training camps. How did Mohammed Siddiqui Khan do that on a schoolteacher's pay? The most likely explanation now is that they were asked to make those videos by MI5. To give themselves some credibility with extremist Muslims and the terrorist training camps, so that they could more easily infiltrate them for MI5 and MI6, who would be financing them and their trips abroad. The same videos could then have been edited and used by the authorities after the 7/7 attacks to try to frame them. People in Beeston who knew them said that they looked younger in those videos than they looked in 2005, and that they did not talk like that, and the movement of their lips did not synchronize with what they were supposedly saying in the videos. Survivors and family members of the deceased have quite rightfully asked why MI5 did not arrest Mohammed Siddiqui Khan and Shehzad Tan Wir as part of Operation Crevice, and thus prevent the 7/7 attacks from happening and save everyone who was affected by 7/7 from being murdered, maimed, injured, bereaved, or traumatized. The only logical answer is that they were British patriots working for MI5 all along,
and then, when they had outlived their usefulness and knew enough to be a liability to MI5, especially if their cover was blown by Operation Crevice, they were set up as patsies and eliminated. As a further indication that they were working for MI5, former Justice Department prosecutor and terror expert John Loftus was filmed in an interview talking about Harun Rashid Aswad, whom we were told by the authorities was the mastermind behind the 7/7 attacks. John Loftus says that Aswad is an MI6 agent.
Aswad is believed to be the mastermind of all the bombings in London.
From on the 7/7 and 7/21, this is the guy, we think.
This is the guy, and what's really embarrassing is that the entire British police are out chasing him, and one wing of the British government, MI6, or the British Secret Service, right, has been hiding him. Now, we knew about this guy, Aswad. Back in 1999, he came to America. The Justice Department wanted to indict him in Seattle, because him and his buddy were trying to set up a terrorist training school in Oregon.
So they indicted the buddy, right? But why didn't they indict him?
Well, it comes out, we've just learned that the headquarters of the U.S. Justice Department ordered the Seattle prosecutors not to touch Aswad.
Hello. Now, hold on. Why?
And that's, well, apparently Aswad was working for British intelligence. Now, Aswad's boss, the one-armed Captain Hook, he gets indicted 2 years later. So the guy above him and below him get indicted, but not Aswad. So all of a sudden, he disappears. He's in South Africa. We think he's dead. We don't know he's down there. Last month, the South African Secret Service come across the guy.
Yeah, now the CIA says, oh, he's alive. Our CIA says, okay, let's arrest him. But the Brits say no again?
The Brits say no. Now, at this point, 2 weeks ago, the Brits know that the CIA wants to get a hold of Harun. So what happens? He takes off again, goes right to London. He isn't arrested when he lands. He isn't arrested when he leaves.
Even though he's on a watch list.
He's on the watch list. The only reason he could get away with that was if he was working for British intelligence. He was a wanted man.
And then takes off the day before the bombings, as I understand it?
Yeah, and goes to Pakistan. The Pakistanis arrest
him. They jail him.
They jail him. He's released within 24 hours.
We were told by the British authorities that the alleged bombers made phone calls to Aswad prior to the explosions. Aswad came into the UK towards the end of June 2005 through the port of Felixstowe. He left the UK on an early morning flight from Heathrow on the day of 7/7. When the police were doing their investigations into the 7/7 atrocity, they came across evidence that Harun Aswad had made mobile phone calls to the alleged suicide bombers just hours before the attacks. He had made about 20 calls to them. With the suspicious travel movements by Harun, and along with the many mobile phone calls he allegedly made, he was designated as prime suspect and mastermind of the 7/7. It was at this point that he was traced to South Africa, Zimbabwe, and watched until he tried to cross the border to Zambia. He was arrested. Once in custody in Zambia, Aswad was then deported to the UK for questioning about 7/7. During this time, MI6 then declared that he was an agent of theirs, and that Aswad had nothing to do with the 7/7 atrocity, and that he will not be interviewed. MI6 basically overrode the police inquiries. All of this information further indicates that 7/7 was a false flag psyop carried out by the security services, and that it was not carried out by Muslims.
It should be noted that neither Mohammed Siddiqui Khan nor Shehzad Tanweer specify what their targets were in their videos. It is also interesting to note that no one has ever claimed responsibility for the 7/7/2005 bombings, except for a message on a fake Al-Qaeda website on the same day that was traced to Texas in the USA.
As already stated, if Tanweer and Khan were working for MI5 and MI6 as informants and asked to infiltrate extremist Muslim groups, then that would explain the making of these videos, to be used as part of their credentials when attempting to gain the trust of extremists.
2 years afterwards, because more and more people doubt the official story and are proving it to be lies and deception, and are rightfully demanding an independent investigation, the police have arrested, frightened, intimidated and harassed Mohammed Siddiqui Khan's widow into publicly condemning her husband. She has a young daughter to protect and has stated that she is now afraid of the police. They kept her in custody for 6 days to intimidate her and then showed her what they claim is her husband's will and suicide note. Obviously, this was done to get her to condemn her husband publicly, in exchange for the authorities' implied agreement to leave her alone, to which she will have agreed, in order to protect herself and her young daughter from further harassment. Where were these documents found, and why did it take 2 years for them to be shown to her? They are, after all, her rightful property, if genuine. 2 years is ample time to forge a short handwritten note and signature on a will. In view of the amount of time this suicide note has taken to be mentioned, the timing of it, and all the lies and evidence the authorities have told, fabricated and planted, it cannot be trusted and must be considered another forgery, along with any other new so-called evidence that they might come up with. So the scene is set for the training exercise to go ahead. The fake terrorists have been recruited, the suicide videos have been made, and everyone has been given basic instructions for the day that the exercise is to be put into operation, 7/7/2005. The four mock terrorist actors were to meet at Luton train station at 07:20 a.m. on the 7th of July 2005 and catch the 07:40 a.m. train from Luton to King's Cross Thameslink station with their pretend bomb backpacks, and then split up and catch 3 tube trains and 1 bus to prearranged destinations, where the fake explosions were to take place as part of the training exercise. Finally, the big day arrived. Everyone was ready. Everyone was either already where he was meant to be or was heading there. But first, let us take a step backwards for a moment to look at the bigger picture, and put this mock terror exercise into context with what was happening in Britain at that time. Tony Blair was in big trouble, because he had just been sent a very clear message from the British nation via the May 2005 general election, in which he was almost voted out of power, that the British people did not want British troops fighting in George Bush's war of terror in the Middle East. So, to be able to keep the British troops fighting in the Middle East, Tony Blair desperately needed something to happen to change the nation's mind. Gleneagles. Tony Blair, George Bush, G8 meeting, agenda of addressing world poverty, forced on them by Live 8 concerts around the world, but not for long. Their lucrative, evil, phony and very unpopular war on terror, which is really a war of terror, will promptly return to the top of the agenda with 4 big bangs. No time for the poor. The rich have lots more money to make and people to murder.
Meredith Hughes, the Chief Constable of South Yorkshire Police, based in Sheffield, was also the head of the Association of Chief Police Officers, ACPO, and he was in charge of the policing of the G8 meeting in Gleneagles on the 7th of July 2005
and played a leading role in the national response to the 7th of July 2005 London bombings. Leeds, where three of the Muslim actors lived and were recruited, and where the oldest, Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, was befriended by the local police and was regularly called upon by them to help them to sort out gang rivalry problems. Mohammed was also taken on a tour of the House of Commons by a Leeds MP who befriended him. The perfect patsy, someone who was made to believe he could trust the authorities and that they would therefore not deceive or harm him. Someone who could in turn recruit two other Muslims for the drill, so they could all become famous and make a nice bit of clean and easy extra money, and show their patriotism by helping the authorities to protect Britain from terrorism. Aylesbury, a fourth Muslim actor who has been recruited, Jermaine Lindsay from Aylesbury, will also meet them in Luton. Luton. Transport security firm ICTS, another Israeli company, has an office just a mile away from the Luton train station, which is suspected to be where the Muslim actors received their final instructions before setting off for the train station. The details of which trains to board, which carriages to get into, where to sit, and which bus to catch, where to sit on it, and at what time.
Another interesting thing about the Israeli firm ICTS is that they also handled the security at the airports in America on 9/11.
London. Commissioner of Police Ian Blair, Rudy Giuliani, Mayor of New York on 9/11, Benjamin Netanyahu, who said 9/11 was good for Israel, Peter Power, and all those taking part in the mock terrorism drill are present in central London, in or around London Underground locations where the explosions take place, and also Tavistock Square.
ICTS also have their UK head office in Tavistock Square, right next to where the number 30 bus blew up. But more about that later.
The four men were supposed to arrive together on time at Luton Station and be caught on CCTV at 07:21:54 a.m. entering the station, but three of them are not on the same video frames as Hasib Hussain, so have to be inserted later using computer software, hence the obviously and very badly doctored official single frame, time-stamped photo that we have been shown from the CCTV outside Luton Station. They can't show them moving because it has been faked. That's why they show only one single frame still photo. Why did the authorities have to fake this photo? They would have had to fake it because three of the actors missed the tube trains that they were supposed to catch and which blew up without them being on board. And so there was no video footage from Verint Systems of them boarding the three tube trains for the authorities to be able to use as false evidence to try to prove to the public that the Muslims were guilty. So they had to doctor and show us the fake photo instead.
Hi, this is Flash MP, and this is Flash MP's guide to July 7th CCTV. I'm going to start off with all the things that are wrong with the Luton image, why this is not proof of anything. Certainly it's not a valuable piece of evidence and would not be admissible in court. Probably start with the most glaring things that are wrong with the Luton image. Firstly being Jermaine Lindsay's left leg. There's a lot wrong with this. There's a triangular chunk missing from his left hip, on the top of his thigh. This is very unusual and obviously is not normal for a human being, and especially at the angle as well. You can also see the top of his thigh is obstructing or is in front of the bottom of his jacket, and you should get a clearer view there. You see the top line of his thigh clearly is in front of his jacket and is not underneath like you would expect. So you can see that there's a lot of merging between the plastic bag that he's holding and his right knee. It's generally a very, very messy area, and it could be because the people who fabricated this image had problems using the original image of Jermaine Lindsay, because this is probably composed of a lot of images that were taken on other days, not on July the 7th. And this is why you probably have the problem with the legs, because Jermaine Lindsay is obviously holding a plastic bag, and they may have only been able to use the upper body part and not being able to use the legs, perhaps because the legs weren't walking in the right direction for this image, or they didn't have the right resolution, or they may have just not looked right and would have looked even more of a hatchet job than this looks. There's a lot of fusion there between his thigh and his right knee, between that and the plastic bag. There's also a sort of another triangular chunk missing at the bottom where his ankle should be, and this again is not normal. It's not a normal characteristic for a human being. Okay, and on to the next anomaly, which is Mohammed Sadiq Khan's lower left arm, or lack of it. Mohammed Sadiq Khan is the man standing behind Jermaine Lindsay in the white hat. Doesn't appear to have a lower left arm in this image. Some people have said that his arms folded across his stomach, or somehow bent behind Jermaine Lindsay. But as you can see, in both those close-up images, there's no elbow that's visible. And if you look behind, you'll see the glass wall where the reflection should be. Whether that's an authentic reflection is unknown, probably unlikely, because there's no left arm there, so it's unlikely that Mohammed Sadiq Khan was standing there on this day. As you can see, there's a glass wall, and it comes down behind, and what you see is Mohammed Sadiq Khan's left arm come down, stopping what is essentially just a straight line. It's just, there's no elbow there at all, and what you'll see behind is the glass wall at Luton Station. And again, this is not a normal characteristic for a human being, and is entirely impossible. Okay, then on to the next anomaly in the Luton image. This is the anomaly associated to Hasib Hussein, and this is the dodgy reflection. What you see on the left is Hasib Hussein in the foreground, and then this is the background of Hasib Hussein on the right, and it essentially looks like someone's taken a stamp, or taken the image on the left and tried to stamp it onto the glass wall behind to make it look like a reflection. Again, this is quite a serious anomaly, and it's entirely impossible. Light does not behave in this way, and reflections do not behave in this way. You should see literally a mirror image of the other side of Hasib Hussein's legs, and the right leg should be in front of the left leg in the reflection, like this. Okay, then let's move on to the next anomalies in the Luton image. The next anomalies are associated to Shahzad Tanweer, who's on the furthest right in the image in the dark hat. There seems to be some sort of impact on the bus stop here. It's very wobbly, it seems to have been disrupted in some way, and that is not present in, or is not the same in, the dummy run image, which is taken from supposedly the same camera at the same angle. And as you can see, the bus stop is a lot straighter, very solid. It's also important to note in the dummy run image that Mohammed Sadiq Khan is wearing the same hat that he's wearing in the Luton image. Also, it's important to note that in the top right hand corner there's some kind of code, perhaps another kind of time and date code, but that's missing from the other image, supposedly July 7th. Also, this image seems to show less of the bus stop than the other image. The police may not have been complicit in the falsifying of the Luton image, however it is quite unlikely, seeing as it was presented in such a way by the police. Okay, then the next image is of Hasib Hussein. This has been used again, like the Luton image, in a lot of media reports, a lot of mainstream media reports, as proof or as evidence that the men were in London on July 7th and were able to carry out the bombings. But this image is proof of nothing, really. It's unknown where this image was taken. There's no time or date code. The other three men should be around him, and none of them are visible. This image is really proof of nothing, and shouldn't be used in any kind of report, mainstream media or not, to substantiate any claims that these men were responsible for the bombing. Also, this image seems to contradict police claims that they travelled together. The other three men should be visible around him, but they're not. Again, this has no time or date code. It's impossible to tell when it was. The question should be asked, why are the police presenting this image as proof? Why are they so eager to put Hasib Hussein and the other men in the frame? And what I was basically trying to show in this video is that even though these images have been used in mainstream media reports, they're really not proof of much, and any report that contains these images is inaccurate, and that issue needs to be addressed. I was also trying to show that the evidence that is available, such as the IDs that were found at the scene and the papers that were found at the scene, is very important if you don't have any CCTV. Of course, some people are going to say that DNA was found at the scene and the papers were found at the scene, and surely that's conclusive proof. It's not impossible to plant DNA at a scene, it's not impossible to plant small fragments of flesh and bone at a scene. It's not difficult, it's definitely not difficult to plant IDs, especially as there are anomalies in the way the IDs were found as well. It's not impossible.
Why do the images of the three on the right look blurred when compared to Hasib Hussain on the left? Is this a cut-and-paste leg? Why the extremely blurred face? This technique matches exactly what is known as the smear tool in image manipulation software. Mohammed Siddiqui Khan in the white hat is standing in front of some railings. The top railing partially merges with his face. The middle railing runs behind him, showing that he is in front of it, and the bottom one runs in front of him. How can this be possible? Try doing this yourself while standing straight up with a backpack on.
This bar here going through Khan, you've got this bar going through his head, okay, and that bar going through his waist. Now I'll just get down so you can see where Khan's head would be. It goes right through his face like that, okay? In the famous picture you've all seen.
The top railing is waist high, approximately 3 feet 6 inches. So Mohammed Siddiqui Khan would have had to have been a dwarf for the railing to be at his head height, and we know he was not a dwarf. Please note the difference in clarity between the trial run pictures on the 28th of June 2005 and the 7th of July 2005. Please note the difference in the shape of the curb in the two photos. This image has clearly been fabricated, possibly by our intelligence services or police, in order to frame these four patsies. Lots of video experts have analysed this Luton Station photo and all agree that it has been fabricated, which is a criminal offence. The fact that it has been fabricated would have any case brought against the alleged bombers thrown out of court, and the fabricator arrested for attempting to pervert the course of justice, which, as I know from my recent experience, carries a maximum life sentence. Remember what Michael Portillo said on the May 2004 BBC Panorama programme. The coverage is going to be organised. So far, they are apparently running according to the training exercise plan and on schedule. Fifth chapter title, The Ghost Trains. Unfortunately for the people who have organised the event, the train that the four Muslim actors are supposed to catch, the 07:40 a.m. train to King's Cross Thameslink, has been cancelled, and the next one too, so they cannot possibly make it in time to catch the tube trains that they were supposed to catch as part of the training exercise. The best laid plans of mice and men often go awry, as the hand of God interferes. In spite of official confirmation that the 07:40 a.m. train was cancelled and the next one too, the Home Office report still contains the lie that the non-existent 07:40 a.m. train was the one that the four Muslims caught. The authorities have to keep lying about it in order to continue to try to make the public believe that three of the four Muslim men who boarded a train from Luton to King's Cross arrived in time to catch the three tube trains that blew up. In doing so, the authorities make it perfectly clear that the truth of what happened that day is of no importance to them. It is obvious from their actions that the only thing that is important to the authorities is to make us believe what they had already planned to make us believe, even when the facts prove it to be a lie.
They even claim to have witnesses on the non-existent train, who they say saw the alleged bombers on the non-existent train. Since then, the government has changed its story, claiming that they caught an earlier train and that they have witnesses who also saw them on the earlier train. Really? It is not possible for them to have caught the earlier train, because the CCTV footage times makes it impossible for them to have caught it. If they were really carrying homemade, very volatile explosives in their heavy backpacks, they most certainly would not have been able to risk running to catch a train.
The first available train the Muslim actors can catch gets them to King's Cross after the tube trains have already left without them. Hasib Hussein splits off from the other three at King's Cross Thames Link station, because he still has time to catch the number 30 bus as his part in the mock terror exercise. When the tube trains they were supposed to catch are blown up, the other three smell a rat and realize they have been duped and are Muslim patsies who will be blamed for the attacks, and everyone knows what happened to Lee Harvey Oswald. The Muslims are not from London. Their homes are many miles away, and so they are like fish out of water and have no idea what to do or where to go and hide. They realize that they can't go home and do not know anyone in London whom they can trust. The phones are all not working, first of all because they were jammed and then shut down by the authorities. So they cannot phone anyone to tell them what has happened. What can they do to prevent themselves from being wrongly blamed for the explosions? What would you do in that situation? On one of the early TV news broadcasts that day, a newsreader announced that a report has come in that three of the terrorists involved in the bombings had been shot and killed by the anti-terrorist branch of the police at Canary Wharf in the Docklands area of London's East End. It was also broadcast on BBC Radio 5 Live. The announcement was made only once and never repeated, for obvious reasons. How could suicide bombers possibly have survived the tube train bombings and then been in the Docklands to be shot? In a New Zealand Herald newspaper article, it says that two people were shot dead outside the HSBC building, and in Canada's Globe and Mail newspaper, only one. There is another newspaper report that the police shot a suicide bomber outside the Credit Suisse First Boston Bank, which is approximately 1,400 feet or 467 yards away from the HSBC building, measured door to door. The two buildings are very different in both shape and size, and 467 yards apart, and thus they are not easily confused with each other. Police were yesterday probing reports a man had been neutralized outside Canary Wharf. It is believed the man was shot dead by police marksmen outside the Credit Suisse First Boston Bank, South London Press.
Tell me, the rumour is that a police sniper shot dead at suicide bomber at Canary Wharf. Do you know anything about that?
That means that the police shot and killed at least three suicide bombers in Canary Wharf on 7/7/2005. How could suicide bombers, who were supposed to have blown themselves up on the three tube trains, have survived and been shot dead at Canary Wharf? If we have at least three of the four suicide bombers shot dead at Canary Wharf, and we know they weren't on the tube trains that blew up, because the 07:40 a.m. train from Luton to King's Cross was cancelled that day, then we have overwhelming proof that they did not blow the tube trains up, and that the blowing up of the three tube trains was an inside job. At the Canary Wharf Docklands site, there are media companies for the Muslim patsies to have told their story to and cleared their names if they could, and two possible escape routes, via air from the nearby London City Airport that has flights to 34 destinations in the UK and Europe, and, if they couldn't fly out, there was the possibility of getting a boat across the channel to France. Sixth chapter title, The Number 30 Bus. The fourth Muslim backpacker, Hasib Hussain, who has been blamed for the Number 30 bus bombing, is reported to have been seen wandering around London, going into McDonald's and eating a beef burger. He is reported to have tried unsuccessfully to contact the other three by phone on Euston Road, outside King's Cross at 08:55 a.m, but the phones were not working because they were first of all jammed and then shut down by the authorities. If these young men were truly suicide bombers who were supposed to have blown themselves up, why would he be trying to phone dead people? However, if they were merely actors playing the part of mock terrorists in a training drill, then trying to phone them would make more sense. What happened to him? He was the youngest of the four, only 18 years old, and described by those who knew him as a gentle giant. Therefore, he was possibly the least worldly wise, and he was also on his own in a strange city and a long way from home. He might not have realized he was in danger of being framed as a patsy, believed all the chaos around that part of London was just part of the mock terrorism exercise that he was part of, and so just continued with his assigned role, which was to board a certain double-decker bus at an appointed time and sit at the back of the top deck. A double-decker upon which a large advertisement for a play had been placed on one side, reading, "Outright Terror, Bold and Brilliant." Please think about that sign on the side of the bus and the sick minds of the people who planned the attacks. Now this is where it gets weird, because we are told that Hasib Hussain started from King's Cross Thameslink station and was seen on a number 91 bus travelling west along Euston Road to Euston Station, where he caught the number 30 bus that would have then travelled east, back along Euston Road, retracing his steps, back to where he started from at King's Cross, if it had not been diverted into Tavistock Square. Why would someone carrying a large, heavy backpack do that, unless he was following a script written by someone who knew in advance that that particular number 30 bus, registration LX03BUF, would be diverted into Tavistock Square and that Hasib Hussain would therefore not be able to get on it at King's Cross Thameslink, which is where he had arrived at on the train from Luton? Only someone who is a stranger to London would do that without asking why, because it is a totally illogical thing to do for someone who knows London and knows that the number 30 bus goes past King's Cross Thameslink station, so that they could have caught it there instead. It would have been a complete waste of time, energy, money, and an unnecessary risk to take, and thus a totally illogical thing for a real terrorist to do. It now gets unbelievably weird, because the number 91 bus that Hasib Hussain is reported to have taken from King's Cross along Euston Road to Euston Station to board the number 30 bus, registration LX03BUF, that got diverted into Tavistock Square, actually goes to Tavistock Square. So, if he wanted to get to Tavistock Square, he could just have stayed on the number 91 bus and been sure of getting directly to Tavistock Square. The number 91 bus route goes from King's Cross to Tavistock Square. That is conclusive proof that that particular number 30 bus, registration LX03BUF, was part of Peter Power and his customers' mock terrorist drill, pre-rigged with explosives, like the three tube trains, and was pre-planned to be diverted into and blown up in Tavistock Square, rather than blown up by a backpack bomb. Whoever planned this obviously planned to kill Hasib Hussain with that bus explosion, so he could not tell anyone what had happened, just as they had planned to kill the other three Muslim actors with the explosions on the three tube trains. At 0900 AM, a number 30 bus, registration LX03BUF, left Marble Arch on its return journey to Hackney Wick. It arrived at Euston bus station at 0935 AM and was then diverted from its normal route into Tavistock Square and stopped outside the medical offices of the BMA, where it was blown up at 0947 AM as part of the terrorist exercise gone live. This also fits with the BBC Panorama mock terrorist programme of May 2004, where the explosion of a road vehicle was scheduled to take place after the three tube train explosions.
The bus bombing in Tavistock Square has the hallmarks of a satanic ritual sacrifice, mimicking the Passover, with blood over the doorposts and lintel, later used in the Beijing Olympics Sikh ritualistic closing ceremony. Tavistock House is where the infamous Tavistock Institute, that initiated the dark art of mind control and psychological warfare against the British people, was founded. Were they trying to tell us something? Or were they leaving a symbolic signature that only those in the know and few others would understand? Passover? PSYOP? So that any high-ranking Freemasons and Zionists who had not been privy to the plans of the false flag attack beforehand, and who are strategically positioned in places of authority throughout society, would quickly fall into line with their script? Notice the roof comes off the bus and the 13 umbrellas representing the 13 people they claim died on the number 30 bus in Tavistock Square. Having now had the opportunity to actually visit Tavistock Square after being extradited to England, I have found out that the Israeli company ICTS's UK head office is in Tavistock Square, actually in Tavistock House, right in front of where the number 30 bus blew up. In fact, if the explosion on the bus had blown forwards instead of backwards, everything would have literally landed on their doorstep, South Entrance D. So, they had a front row seat from which to watch the explosion, perhaps even to have detonated the explosives from there as well. How fortunate for them that the explosion was at the back of the bus, close enough to watch it without getting hurt by it. The driver of the bus on that day was not the regular driver. Why did the driver stop the bus in that exact spot? Employees at the stagecoach garage said that on the Saturday before 7-7, a team of people came to service the CCTV system on bus LX03BUF, and that they were not the usual people, and, unlike the usual people, they were unfriendly and wouldn't have anything to do with the garage staff. They also spent more than 20 hours working on it, an unheard-of length of time for that job, which would normally take a couple of hours. What were they doing? Rigging the bus with explosives and sabotaging the cameras? There is a photo showing what appears to be an angle grinder cut, as though the bus was cut ready for the roof to blow off. Normally, with a bomb inside a bus, the roof would stay on and just the windows blow out. So, this again is not normal. Another explanation for that cut could be that it was made by a shaped explosive cutter charge. The top of the bus appears to have been very cleanly cut off in an exact straight line.
A white van from a demolition company called Kingstar is seen and photographed parked at the side of the bus immediately after the explosion, and a mysterious witness, Richard Jones, gives an account of what he says happened to the bus on camera, which is something that normally would not be allowed by the police unless it was part of a film training exercise. Then, after a spate of very contradictory TV and newspaper interviews, within a very short space of time, that makes sure everyone now believes the explosion was caused by a suicide bomber on the bus, Richard Jones disappears from view. However, and of particular interest, some newspapers, including the UK's Sunday Mail on the 10th of July 2005, reported that Richard Jones served an apprenticeship at an explosives factory in Ayrshire. Richard Jones' statements about the suicide bomber are very suspicious for two reasons. First, because they are so inconsistent and contradictory that they are not believable. And second, because criminals usually accuse someone else to divert attention away from themselves. Is that what Richard Jones did? He says that he and 11 other people got off the bus just before it exploded. Were the 12 of them a team, with the other 11 there to cover up what Richard Jones was doing as he planted a bomb? Another strange statement he made to the Sun newspaper, reported in the 8th of July 2005 edition, is that he got off the bus because he had reached his destination. How could he possibly have reached his destination on a bus that had been diverted from its normal route, unless he was part of the mock terrorism exercise team and got off the bus as planned in Tavistock Square after planting a bomb just before it was detonated? Does he work for Kingstar? Kingstar, whose white van was parked next to the bus, is a company that specializes in controlled demolitions, and Richard Jones said he served an apprenticeship at an explosives factory in Ayrshire. Was the Kingstar van there as part of Peter Power and his customers' training mock terrorism drill to supervise the mock explosion that became real?
Kingstar took part in the BBC Two hit piece Conspiracy Files 77, and stated that the back of their van was caved in and needed to be repaired.
When the explosion happened, the back of the doors got caved in and the roof was dented through, for whatever reason, I'm not sure, but something hit the top of the roof.
But if you inspect the photos taken on 77, there is no sign of any damage to the van. Even the relatively fragile plastic rear lights are intact. So it appears that their statements cannot be trusted.
If Haseeb Hussain was supposed to have been on that number 30 bus, registration LX03BUF, how would it be possible for him to get the exact bus that would get him to one of the four locations where the mock terrorist exercise would be taking place, when that bus was diverted from its normal route to Tavistock Square, unless he had been recruited to play the part of a mock terrorist and told exactly which bus to get, where and at what time, by the people who organised the mock terrorism exercise and who knew the bus would be diverted to Tavistock Square. The odds against that happening by coincidence are unbelievable, and thus it is not possible that it was a coincidence. Another unbelievable coincidence is that all of the CCTV cameras at all four of the blast sites were not working that day. The four CCTV cameras on the number 30 bus were, just like the Israeli Verint Systems ones on the underground, not working, and there are no reliable witnesses who can place Hasib Hussein on the number 30 bus. Richard Jones is an unreliable witness whose physical descriptions of the man he says was the suicide bomber does not fit with Hasib Hussein's appearance or what he was wearing that day. So there is no proof that Hasib Hussein was either on that bus or blew it up. Even so, he has been tried and wrongfully found guilty of blowing up the number 30 bus by the government-organized and controlled media machine without a shred of real evidence.
They claim to have found Hasib Hussein's ID in Tavistock Square. However, they also state that ID from another of the four, Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, was found at all four separate blast locations. He cannot possibly have been in two, never mind three or all four locations at the same time, proving that these items were planted after the blasts.
How could their IDs have survived suicide bomb blasts? Millions of people are aware of the magic fireproof Mohammed Atta passport that was planted at the World Trade Center on 9/11. In light of these incidents, if ID from Hasib Hussein was found at Tavistock Square, it does not necessarily mean that he was on the bus and not somewhere else. Or, if he was on the bus, that he blew the bus up.
There is no credible witness who has placed Hasib Hussein on that number 30 bus, and that includes Lisa French, who took 5 years before she supposedly remembered seeing him, and then gets the bag wrong, saying it was a square laptop bag, not a big rucksack. Also, people who were sitting around the seat he is reported to have been sitting in did not see him. Does this look like a laptop bag to you?
What has happened to the presumption of innocence and being considered innocent until proven guilty and convicted by a jury of your peers in court? That has always been the mainstay of British justice. The most likely case is that the number 30 bus had been pre-rigged with explosives during its previous service when the CCTV cameras were disabled. The CCTV systems on stagecoach buses are normally either the Israeli company Verint Systems RP12001 or Timespace X200. A witness, Rishmal Marie Oates Whitehead, aged 35, who worked at the BMA in Tavistock Square and was hailed as a heroine for her actions during the London bombings, said she heard two explosions on the bus. The controlled media immediately went on the offensive and did a character assassination of the heroine, because her testimony did not fit with the official story, and she died unexpectedly shortly afterwards. However, other witnesses also reported a second explosion on the bus. Rishmal's and other witnesses' testimonies would account for pre-planted explosives and a bomb being planted later on 7/7/2005. What we can be certain about, though, is that, either on the bus or elsewhere, Hasib Hussain, like the other three Muslim patsies, was murdered. 7th chapter title, Pre-planted Explosives. Witnesses of the tube train explosions state that there were no Muslims with backpacks and no backpacks or bags left unattended on the trains in the carriages that blew up, and the floors of the trains blew upwards from underneath, not downwards, as would be the case with explosives inside the trains.
I just got on the train, sat down reading the newspaper about us getting the Olympics in 2012, and I've had quite a good feeling about everything. Sitting on the train, going to my audition. Must have been not much longer than 30 seconds. All of a sudden, it didn't feel like I was on the train anymore. Something was very, very different. It was very strange. I had this very heavy feel to it, this very heavy kind of not of this world feel to it. As I was getting off the train, I noticed that there was a hole, and the hole was as if there was a bomb or the explosion had burst up through the floor of the train. And that was just about there.
Explosives under the train floors, powerful enough to rupture the carriage floors and bend them upwards, would also lift the carriages up off the rails and derail them, as did happen. Those explosives were not homemade, but military-grade high explosives that would not be available to Muslim suicide bombers. The official story was that they used homemade explosives, which has later been proven to be a lie. The presence of military-grade high explosives was confirmed by Christophe Chabot, head of the French Anti-Terrorism Coordination Unit, as well as Scotland Yard's Deputy Assistant Commissioner, Brian Paddick. Forensic investigations are a scientific process. The discovery of military-grade explosives, confirmed by experienced professionals, doesn't just happen by accident. They also stated that the bombs were detonated by timing devices, not by suicide bombers. This is the Russell Square tube carriage that Jermaine Lindsay allegedly blew up. Further proof that the government lied about the explosives is the fact that the explosives that were used could not have been homemade in a bath TATP, because TATP explodes without generating any flames or heat. And we know, from the famous photograph of the woman in the Burns mask, that the explosives that were used burned her and others. So we know, from reliable eyewitnesses who can be traced, that there were no backpack homemade bombs or Muslim bombers inside the tube train carriages that blew up, and that the floors blew upwards, so the bombs, which were made from military-grade explosives, must have been fastened underneath the floors of the train carriages. Only people having access to the tube trains during the times that the trains were not running would be able to plant those bombs under the train floors. Benjamin Netanyahu, the Israeli finance minister, said that he was warned by Scotland Yard not to leave his hotel room on the morning of 7/7/2005, before the first explosion was reported, implying that they had foreknowledge of the plan. Scotland Yard then quickly denied being the ones who had provided the warning, but have not told us who did warn Netanyahu if they did not. Why was Benjamin Netanyahu warned, but not the British people who pay their wages and whom they are paid to protect? Was it because it would have spoiled their evil plan to murder British people, to change the nation's mind about British troops fighting in the Middle East? 2 weeks later, the head of the Israeli Mossad, General Meir Dagan, said that he had warned Benjamin Netanyahu at 08:40 a.m. on 7/7/2005, 10 minutes before the first blast occurred. How did he know what was going to happen in London if Scotland Yard did not warn him? Did he wait to warn Benjamin Netanyahu until it was too late to warn the British people, so as not to spoil their evil plan? Was the London bombing a covert MI5 operation, or an Israeli Mossad operation, or a joint operation by both of them? The British people have the right to know. Tony Blair said on the day of the explosions that
"We know that these people act in the name of Islam,"
when there was no proof whatsoever of who had done it, therefore indicating he possibly had foreknowledge of the plan and who they intended to blame and the reason why they were going to blame the Muslims. As proof that this was a slip-up and needed covering up, look at how the BBC later falsely reported his actual words, giving further proof that the BBC is a government propaganda machine and the coverage was organised, exactly as Michael Portillo said it would be in the BBC Panorama programme in May 2004. Later that same day, Ephraim Halevi, a former head of the Israeli Mossad, wrote in an article published on the Jerusalem Post website at 18:10 p.m. London time, that the attacks had been carried out simultaneously with near-perfect execution. How did he know they had only been near-perfect? How could he have known what the perfect results should have been, in order to know that the actual results were not perfect, unless he was in on the plot? How many more people had they intended to murder in order for it to be considered perfect execution? How did he know, at least 2 days before the London authorities released the information on the 9th of July, that the bombs were detonated simultaneously, unless he was in on the plot? As proof that this too was a slip-up, the Jerusalem Post article in question was completely removed from their website after people began to ask similar questions. The following day, Police Commissioner Ian Blair also made a slip-up on camera and said that there were 4 miserable bombers, and then very quickly corrected himself, showing that he too possibly had foreknowledge of the plan to use 4 Muslims as patsies.
If London could survive the Blitz, it can survive 4 miserable bombers like this. I'm not saying there are 4 bombers, 4 miserable events like this.
We are told that the first reports were of an electrical power surge that occurred. And then later, we were told that there were bombs that exploded on the tube trains and that it was an Al-Qaeda terrorist attack, with Muslim suicide bombers carrying backpack homemade explosive devices onto the tube trains. A couple of weeks later, a Brazilian contract electrician is brutally and publicly murdered on a tube train. And again, we are told lies by the police and media about him. He was a contract electrician. For whom had he been working, and what had he been working on in the days leading up to the 7th of July 2005? Remember that the first reports from the media about 7/7/2005 were of an electrical power surge, and John Charles de Menezes was a contract electrician. Was he hired as part of the terrorist exercise's 1,000 people to wire up devices for mock explosions to be set off by a power surge? Did he see the explosive devices being fastened under the tube train carriage floors and later realise what had really happened and was starting to talk about it? Did they, the hierarchy enslaving him, publicly execute him to shut him up and as a warning to others to keep their mouths shut? We have been unable to find out where he worked. We know about his cousins who live in London and his family coming over from Brazil, but we do not know where he worked. Why? The murder of John Charles de Menezes is also very suspicious because of what the authorities did, or, in reality, what they didn't do that day, which should have been standard operating procedure if they really did believe he was a suicide bomber wearing explosives. If they really believed he was wearing explosives, they would absolutely not have let him get on a bus or a tube train. They would have taken him down when he was in the middle of a street, equidistant from the buildings on either side of the street, in order to minimize the risk to the neighbors. They absolutely would not have let him get on a bus unless it was all scripted as another psyop to reinforce in the public's mind the attacks of 7/7 2 weeks previously. They let him get on a red bus to remind the public of Tavistock Square, and then onto a tube to remind them of the three tube bombings and keep the public in a continual state of fear, to make them more easily manipulated and amenable to allowing more anti-terrorist legislation to be passed, to remove even more of their freedom, and more draconian measures to be taken by the police to protect them. It would also send a message that if anyone talked, this would happen to them too. According to an article by international investigator Peter Ayres in his blog, John Charles de Menezes was murdered because he was about to become a whistleblower, having previously installed ADT CCTV cameras, which generated images of the real 7th of July 2005 bombers. Quoting directly from his blog at section 16, Cressida Dick is a Matrix 5 principal and an alleged early adopter of the Joint Automated Booking Station, JABS, for spoliation of evidence at crime scenes associated with murder for hire. She was an alleged lesbian principal in a LIBOR contract for the use of a gold room JABS to coordinate the 2005 London Underground bombing campaign. She allegedly used the gold room to coordinate the July 22nd murder of prospective gold room whistleblower John Charles de Menezes, a Brazilian technician who had installed ADT CCTV cameras which generated images of the real July bombers. This supports the analysis in my original 7/7 Ripple Effect film being correct and the truth of this film. Who is the person calling himself Richard Jones and claiming to have been next to the suicide bomber on the bus and a witness to the bus bombing? And why did he tell so many lies? Why did Peter Power smirk, grin and giggle when he spoke about the coincidence that the exercise had turned out to be real when lots of people had been killed and injured? What is funny about that? The probability of the 7/7/2005 drill and attack coinciding without being planned to coincide in a 10-year period is 1 chance in 3715592613265 75000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000 I wonder why the media aren't investigating the drill. Why are Peter Power, Verint Systems, Richard Jones, Commissioner Ian Blair, the anti-terrorist branch who shot and murdered these innocent people, the Israeli Mossad, Tony Blair, and the government itself not under investigation for these horrendous crimes? 8th chapter title, conclusion. The times of the trains and tube trains on that day have been carefully checked. The first train after 07:40 a.m. left Luton at 07:56 a.m. and arrived at King's Cross Thameslink station at 08:42 a.m. The three tube trains that blew up left King's Cross Underground station at 08:35 a.m. the eastbound Circle Line train number 204. 08:42 a.m. the westbound Circle Line train number 216. 08:48 a.m. the Piccadilly Line train south. It was therefore impossible for any of the four accused Muslims to have caught the tube trains that blew up. If we have at least three of the four suicide bombers being shot dead at Canary Wharf, and we know they weren't on the tube trains because the 07:40 a.m. train from Luton to King's Cross was cancelled that day, and the photo of them outside Luton station at 07:21:54 a.m. is a fake, and that Hasib Hussain was part of the mock terrorism exercise, then we have overwhelming proof that the four accused Muslims were patsies and are innocent, and that it was an inside job, and that, like Lee Harvey Oswald, they too have been murdered to silence them. Whether the bombings were done by MI5, the Israeli Mossad, or both of them, and or others, has yet to be determined. But the one thing that we can be sure of is that it was not done by four young Muslims.
It has subsequently come to light through an Israeli Mossad agent's Freudian slip, where he admitted on camera in a July 2007 Fox News interview that the Israelis had easily planted bombs on transport vehicles in London, obviously with the complicity of the UK establishment on the 7th of July 2005.
Even with added security, it's hard to erase the fears that something like the British bombing attempts could happen here. We're joined this morning by Juval Aviv, an international security and intelligence expert and the author of Staying Safe. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you very much for having me.
So when you think about what a fireworks display is, it's a bunch of people, strangers, coming together at night, expecting loud explosions.
That's right.
And yet, we've never really had an incident on a 4th of July. You'd think that would be a real target for terrorists,
well,
is it?
Well, those kind of events are always a target. It's a lot of people gathered in one place. It's an easy target, relatively. But terrorists are not stupid. They know that this area is going to be secure. There's going to be a lot of police. New York City has done a marvelous job with the limited budget they have. And I think the area is going to be safe. What we have to worry about is really side street, other parts of the city that won't have that kind of a coverage, police coverage, today. And it's easy to put a truck bomb, as we did, as happened in London. And happens in Iraq or Israel on a weekly basis.
It's easy to put a truck bomb, as we did, as happened in London.
Jamal Aviv is a former Israeli counterintelligence officer.
First of all, we need to understand that terrorism is here to stay. It's not something that have happened as a fluke in 9/11 and will not happen again. Terrorism is here, and terrorism will thrive here for quite a while. Our government is not ready yet to protect us. It takes years of hard work to come up with schemes that have worked somewhere else and introduce them to the public.
This further proves that the film 77 Ripple Effect is 100% accurate and is what really did happen on the 7th of July 2005 in London, and that the four young Muslims were indeed innocent patsies.
The sham inquest, in which there were no autopsies and which never looked into who carried out the bombings, showed even more holes in the government's official conspiracy theory. It was a complete sham and wasted millions of pounds of your money, from which they all made a fortune. Everything that was revealed in the sham inquest further undermines the official story and reinforces my findings in the original version of 77 Ripple Effect. Absolutely nothing they have said since the film's first release on the 5th of November 2007 has undermined the truth of my film. Everything has confirmed its veracity. The most glaring hole in the government story, demonstrated in the sham inquest, is that there were three holes in the Edgware Road tube carriage floor that three people fell into, one into each hole, and that is the carriage that Mohammed Siddiqui Khan is alleged to have been on. Number 10 in the diagram is Khan. Number 13 is Daniel Biddle. Number 16 is John Tulloch. Please notice that Khan is not near the blast location in the police diagram above.
This gets clarified and resolved at the inquest. At the inquest, you've got three major holes in the floor, and one of them is about 10 or 15 feet away from the other two. And these are huge holes, and in all three of them, somebody falls into the hole. That's the amazing thing. Right. And they describe falling into the hole, but with one of them, the person falls in and is stuck there and dies. And the other two, they managed to get out again. So we've not only got three holes, but we've got accounts of three different people falling into those three holes. And the position where they put Khan is supposed to be at Edgware Road, is nowhere near any of those holes. He has to be located.
He's the one who last week we suggested wasn't even there.
He wasn't in there, no, of course. He was put on a bunch of four seats by himself. They have no one else sitting. No one else sitting around him, because they don't want any witnesses to be questioned saying, no, I didn't see Khan, and no, I'm not blind to bits. So they have him sitting by himself with a rucksack. Has to be on his lap, because that's Biddle's account, Danny Biddle. So he pulls a cord. And if you did that, you wouldn't make a hole in the floor at all. But in any case, the three huge holes in the floor are nowhere near Khan.
So now, you wouldn't make three holes in the floor?
Certainly not. Clearly shows a bomb, a blast underneath the train. That's the key thing. Let me emphasise that in all these train stories, the most haunting, horrific factor that keeps appearing is people with legs and feet blown off. This is what the government and the media totally ignore throughout this inquest, just as they totally ignored it back in the 2006 London, Greater London Assembly hearing. They kept hearing the haunting things. Oh, how come my leg's blown off? How come my foot's missing? What we actually need is a map of the train showing everyone with legs and feet missing.
Right.
That would give you a kind of diagram. And I think you'd find rather long areas down the centre of the train. You wouldn't find it, as it were, right, from the centre.
So suggesting that there was explosives planted underneath the train.
Yeah.
Speaking of the Edgware Road, during my extradition journey to Belgravia Police Station, I was driven down Edgware Road by three SO15 anti-terrorist branch officers, and it was full of Muslims. Muslim shops and businesses, and Muslim people shopping and milling around. Ask yourself this: why would a Muslim suicide bomber want to risk blowing up Muslims? how would that advance his cause? In fact, why would Muslims want to blow up anyone in London when Londoners had been demonstrating in vast numbers against the war in the Middle East? It would be absolutely counterproductive. Who gained from it? Certainly not Muslims. The military-industrial oil complex, the weapons manufacturers, the oil companies and the Israelis all gained from it. The Muslims did not. Back now to the sham inquest. There were no autopsies. The incredible timing of the De Boer contract for the mortuary needs to be mentioned here in relation to the bombings. Based in Northamptonshire in the UK, the company De Boer had already completed several contracts for the Metropolitan Police. The De Boer team spent months visiting permanent mortuaries and attending meetings with London Resilience to suggest a suitable structure and interior design. 6 months later, on July the 6th, 2005, a document arrived at De Boer's UK headquarters, finalising what had been agreed for a future crisis response. Within 24 hours, the plan was being realised and implemented with the creation of a temporary mortuary in the grounds of the Honourable Artillery Company near Moorgate Underground Station in central London. Source: London's Response to 7/7, David Donegan, Office of the Strategic Health Authorities at an NHS. The following conversation that took place in the Lady in Justice Hallett sham inquest demonstrates how it was clearly a sham and a cover-up because of things like this. Mr. Chowdhury stated, "I have not seen the post-mortem report, but I thought that she was bleeding from somewhere. So, if the post-mortem says that she was not bleeding from anywhere, just had a spinal injury, I will be surprised." He was answered, "Since you ask about the post-mortem, can I simply inform you that, as with all the other casualties of the day, no internal post-mortem was conducted into Gladys Wundowa. So, unfortunately, much as we would like the answers to the questions that you've asked, they don't." He then said, I am absolutely sure that she had had internal injury as well as a spinal injury, and I'm absolutely surprised that a post-mortem has not been done through and through." They replied to him, "Well, Mr. Chowdhury, that isn't a matter to concern you." "Sorry, we don't need to concern ourselves about that matter." Why were no autopsies done? You can't have a proper inquest without autopsies to find out exactly what killed them. One reason why they would not want an autopsy is because it would disclose what type of explosives were used and prove the government's elaborate homemade explosives and 18 Alexandra Grove bomb factory story to be a total fabrication and a massive lie. The body count reveals no bombers. The first official body count on two of the trains was one body short. At the 7/7 sham inquest in November 2010, Dr. Morgan Costello gave evidence that he was asked to attend two scenes, Edgware Road and Aldgate, for the purposes of certifying the extinction of life. He counted 6 bodies at Edgware Road and 7 bodies at Aldgate and declared these as life extinct. The enormous anomaly that passed completely unreported in the press was that the numbers should have been 7 and 8 if we count the bodies of the bombers. Aren't these two body counts extraordinarily powerful proof that there were no suicide bombers on the Aldgate and Edgware Road tube trains? We were told by very reliable sources that the bombs were military high-grade explosives detonated by timing devices, not by suicide bombers, and survivor Bruce Late says that Shahzad Tanweer did not blow up Aldgate Tube. Note that the man next to Tanweer, coloured green and given the number 8 in the drawing, was not killed. If Tanweer was blown into 52 pieces, how could this man next to him still be alive? Evidence presented to the sham inquest claimed that Tanweer and Khan were blown into a large number of different pieces by their bombs. But how would this be consistent with the fact that almost all of the other serious injuries in those coaches were lower limb injuries, the feet and legs, indicating that the bomb was at floor level, not on someone's back? Also, it has been reported that Shahzad Tanweer's body and head were blown into so many small pieces that he was unidentifiable, and that's why he did not show up as part of the body count. The inquest stated that Tanweer was blown into 52 small pieces. However, a couple of 7-7 investigators spent some days in the Beeston area of South Leeds in 2006 and were able to speak to members of the families and those who knew them. Two friends of the Tanweer family related the astonishment which the latter experienced upon being given back the body of Tanweer and finding it relatively intact. Remember that Bruce Late said that Shahzad Tanweer was not on that train.
Now then, Nick, on the last show we mentioned that the families are rumoured to have identified bodies of the alleged bombers, and they were intact, even though we were told they were in pieces.
Yeah, this is especially so for the Tanweer family.
Tanweer, Shahzad Tanweer.
Shahzad Tanweer in Beeston, buried in Pakistan, yeah.
All right. So, and I mean, have we got testimony from his family saying that his body was intact?
Afraid not, no. But there's a couple of quite reliable truth investigators who spent a week in Leeds, and they got testimony from friends of the family saying that. And it's on the official Confusion website, and that is a fairly reliable source.
All right.
I mean, we would really, really like to have Bialik meet the families and talk to them and ask them these questions, as you know, Richard.
Yes.
And it is, unfortunately, very difficult to get to speak to virtually any of the key people in the story.
Right. Ninth chapter title, Epilogue. Hopefully, among the security services, there must be at least some decent, honest people who know that the official story is a pack of lies and are troubled by it. Unfortunately, they are all keeping quiet about it. We need them to have the courage to come forward and say what they know, and arrest their evil colleagues and bring them to justice, if they don't want to be also condemned as accomplices of the government and media criminals who committed treason and mass murder that day and helped to cover it up, enabling the Orwellian Big Brother police state plans for Britain to pick up steam. And the real perpetrators, the New World Order government terrorists, to plunge the world into World War III and Armageddon. Tony Farrell, who was South Yorkshire Police's principal intelligence analyst for 12 years and a devout Christian, was troubled by the lies and was the first insider to bravely stand up for the truth. A sergeant with the London Anti-Terrorist Branch, who is also a Christian, has now started to sue the Metropolitan Police over the murder of John Charles de Menezes. So we have another brave Christian soul willing to stand up for the truth. What's wrong with the rest of you insiders, you spineless cowards? And where are the millions of Muslims in all of this? Why do Christians have to stand up for the Muslims and suffer losing their jobs and livelihoods? Why aren't Muslims getting involved en masse and helping us to clear these young Muslim men's names and thereby exonerate their religion? Tony Farrell had worked for South Yorkshire Police, the 13th largest of the 44 police forces in the UK, for 17 years and had been employed for 12 years as their principal intelligence analyst. His job involved producing a yearly strategic threat assessment matrix to determine how the police force had to prioritise its activities. He said that after analysing 9/11 and 7/7 and watching my 7/7 ripple effect video, the biggest threat was from the government, for which he was naturally sacked, because of the cowardly institutionalised denial of the truth by South Yorkshire Police. He was not willing to be an accomplice after the fact to these horrendous crimes and mass murder. Those who are keeping quiet are accomplices to mass murder and are also committing misprision of treason, which carries a maximum life sentence. South Yorkshire Police sacked their long-standing, most senior principal intelligence analyst, Tony Farrell, rather than investigate what he had stated in his analysis. Meredith Hughes, who was the chief constable of South Yorkshire Police, absolutely refused to investigate Tony Farrell's analysis that supports the contents of my original 7/7 ripple effect film. Meredith Hughes was in charge of the policing of the G8 meeting in Gleneagles on the 7th of July 2005, and Tony Farrell's boss, DCI Steve Williams, told Tony on the 7th of July 2010 that he was in London on the 7th of July 2005 as part of the terrorist training exercise and knew exactly who had carried it out, thus destroying Peter Power's modified story that it was only a desktop exercise in one room involving himself and five executives of Reed Elsevier, whereas his original story was that it involved over 1,000 people. Were Chief Constable Meredith Hughes and Detective Chief Inspector Steve Williams of South Yorkshire Police involved in the planning of the bombings on the 7th of July 2005, and was that why they sacked Tony Farrell rather than investigate his analysis to cover up their part in it? They can't sack everyone. Come on, stand up and be counted. Do the job you are paid to do, like brave Tony Farrell did. He was sacked for doing his job properly and refusing to tell and peddle the government's lies. Where is your backbone? Or are you spineless cowards and have a yellow streak instead of a backbone? One day you will meet your maker and have absolutely no excuse for your inaction. Wake up from the conditioning and mind control programming you have been subjected to, and the cognitive dissonance and institutionalized denial you are suffering from. The sleeper must awaken. The sleeper must awaken. Why do you think they have made a Big Brother TV program? To program people's minds and get them used to the idea of living under constant surveillance, and to like it, and volunteer to take part in it. Why do you think they are called programs? It is because they are used for mind control, brainwashing, programming of the public's minds into obeying and sleepwalking whilst following their New World Order hidden agenda. The sleeper must awaken. The sleeper must awaken. The television is the greatest mind control and propaganda weapon ever invented. Do you think you should be paying for a TV license to fund all their programming of your mind and the lies and propaganda they are broadcasting to deceive, brainwash, control and enslave everyone, including you? Does the TV and watching it not already control most of your life and the way you think?
Woe is us! We're in a lot of trouble! Because you people and 62 million other Americans are listening to me right now. Because less than 3% of you people read books. Because the only truth you know is what you get over this tube. Right now, there is a whole, an entire generation that never knew anything that didn't come out of this tube. This tube is the gospel, the ultimate revelation. This tube can make or break presidents, popes, Prime Ministers, this tube is the most awesome goddamn force in the whole godless world. And woe is us. This company is now in the hands of the Illusion Corporation of America. There's a new chairman of the board, and when the 12th largest company in the world controls the most awesome goddamn propaganda force in the whole godless world, who knows what shit will be peddled for truth on this network. So you listen to me. Listen to me. Television is not the truth. Television is a goddamn amusement park. Television is a circus, a carnival, a traveling troupe of acrobats, storytellers, dancers, singers, jugglers, sideshow freaks, lion tamers, and football players. We're in the boredom-killing business. So if you want the truth, go to God. Go to yourselves, because that's the only place you're ever going to find any real truth. But man, you're never going to get any truth from us. We'll tell you anything you want to hear. We lie like hell. We'll tell you any shit you want to hear. We deal in illusions, man. None of it is true. But you people sit there day after day, night after night, all ages, colors, creeds. We're all you know. You're beginning to believe the illusions here. You're beginning to think that the tube is reality and that your own lives are unreal. You do whatever the tube tells you. You dress like the tube. You eat like the tube. You raise your children like the tube. You even think like the tube. This is mass madness, you maniacs. In God's name, you people are the real thing. We are the illusion. So turn off your television sets. Turn them off now. Turn them off right now. Turn them off and leave them off. Turn them off!
Do you think you should be paying for all those CCTV cameras and their operatives to spy on you everywhere you go so they can enslave you and fine you, thereby stealing your money for doing nothing wrong? Especially when they use your own money from those fines and taxes to pay for even more CCTV cameras, so you have even less privacy and freedom. And then they claim that the cameras do not work when there is a real crime being committed by the people who control the cameras. Don't you realize that in paying fines and taxes, you are actually paying for the chains they are using to enslave you with? Wake up, look and see the reality that you are actually paying for them to turn you into their slave. The government is continually and illegally passing new legislation to restrict your freedom and obtain more and more information about you to control you, and yet they themselves are becoming more and more secretive and out of control. They have turned the relationship between the people and government into the opposite of what it should be. It should be public servants serving the people, not the people serving public government masters or, more accurately, dictators. Please, for your own sakes, obtain copies of this film for everyone you know and for the media outlets in your area, to wake them up and let everyone know the truth, so that the public will give the decent, honest people in the security services, like Tony Farrell, their support and encouragement to tell the truth and arrest their evil colleagues. Addendum. I was arrested and extradited to the UK on a false, malicious and politically motivated trumped-up charge that had no chance of succeeding, but was designed to punish me for having made 7-7 Ripple Effect and exposing the truth for the whole world to see. Their objective was to shut me up, literally, and make an example of me to deter others from speaking the truth. During my trial, in all the local newspapers throughout the British Isles, they quoted that I had told John Hyman that his daughter Miriam was not on the number 30 bus. Here is proof that she wasn't on that bus. The parents of Miriam Hyman, 32, a freelance picture researcher from East Finchley, North London, don't know what else they can do. They last spoke to her around 9:30 a.m. on Thursday when she was outside King's Cross. She had been trying to get to work at Canary Wharf. "We've had no news," said her father, John, who is retired. "She certainly wasn't injured on the underground, because I spoke to her, and at that time she was with a crowd of people evacuated from trains on the pavement outside King's Cross station. The only other possibility, apart from a road accident, is if she was on the bus that was blown up. The reason we think that is unlikely is because it wouldn't make sense for her to take that route. And I was speaking to her about that time, and her office phoned her at about 10 a.m, which was about 10 minutes after the explosion, to say, 'Don't come in.'" And from another article in the Something Jewish paper, Miriam Hyman, 32, called her father from outside King's Cross station at 9:45 a.m. on Thursday morning and said she was fine, but her family has not heard from her since. She called her dad at 9:45 from King's Cross station, and the number 30 bus blew up in Tavistock Square at precisely 9:47, only 2 minutes later. "It takes 10 minutes to walk from King's Cross to Euston, and it is therefore impossible for her to have been on that bus and been killed on it, and then her office to speak to her at 10 a.m. to tell her not to come into work at Canary Wharf, the place where 3 alleged suicide bombers were shot and killed that morning, just like John Charles de Menezes was 2 weeks later. Her dad, John Hyman, confirmed to us that his daughter Miriam phoned him at 9:45 from King's Cross. Did she ignore her officer's instructions not to come into work at Canary Wharf and meet the alleged suicide bombers on the way, and was killed along with them? Then her parents told that she died on the number 30 bus? Or, as some people believe, Miriam is still alive?"
Some new evidence has recently come to light. I was contacted a few weeks ago by a man whose friend was at a Thameslink line station on the morning of 7/7. He was of Muslim appearance and waiting on the platform at Gatwick station. At 10 a.m. he was singled out by 10 armed police bearing large MP5 submachine guns, wearing black bulletproof vests and white shirts. They were pointing their guns straight at him, and he feels quite lucky to still be alive. He has documentary evidence to prove he was apprehended at this location and at that time. Now, let's just assume that the alleged bombers who were stranded at King's Cross, not knowing what to do after real bombs had gone off, headed back to the Thameslink platform from which they had got off earlier. This isn't unreasonable. Remember, they had very little knowledge of London, and it is more likely they would flee to a known route, perhaps retracing their tracks. If they went back to the same platform and jumped on the first train, this would be a Thameslink line train heading south. Such a train would go to Gatwick and could explain why the man was mistakenly apprehended at gunpoint at the Thameslink Gatwick platform at 10 a.m. The authorities could have easily tracked the men to the Thameslink train using either CCTV or mobile phone positions. Looking at the Thameslink route map, they perhaps thought Gatwick might be a likely destination for the fleeing patsies. But if the patsies changed trains at London Bridge to get on the Jubilee line, where does this go? You guessed it, Canary Wharf, where they were shot at around 10:30 a.m. The time of 10 a.m. at Gatwick ties in with the bombers fleeing south on the Thameslink line at about 9:10 a.m. which is 20 minutes after the bombs went off. If they left King's Cross at 9:10 a.m. on a Thameslink train, that would get them to London Bridge by 9:35. Allowing 15 minutes at London Bridge station, they would have arrived at Canary Wharf at about 10 a.m. This gets them to Canary Wharf in time to be shot, as reported in various newspapers, at 10:30 a.m. It really is an utter disgrace that myself, Nick Collestrom, and others have to do the job of the police and the media because they haven't investigated this case correctly. But hey, they are controlled by the strings of power which prevent them from doing this. What utter spineless wastes of space they really are.
I and other very serious truth seekers have been repeatedly verbally attacked for our work in exposing the truth about 7/7 by people who, strangely enough, claim to want the same thing we do, but go around vociferously attacking us everywhere they can for no good reason. They are acting like gatekeepers to try to prevent us from succeeding in opening the floodgates and shining the light of truth on the real perpetrators of 7/7. Lenin said that the best way to control the opposition is by leading it, and that role of gatekeeper is played very well by Rachel North and Bridget Dunn and other members of J7, who have consistently gone out of their way everywhere they can, as often as they can, to attack other truth seekers, including myself, to try to undermine us and thereby prevent us from succeeding in bringing the real perpetrators to justice. The best way to control the opposition is to lead it ourselves. Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. One can understand the scurrilous beneath contempt BBC attacking us, because, after all, they are the government's official propaganda and disinformation agency. And they, in fact, did attack and try to discredit me and others with their Conspiracy Files 7/7 hit piece. However, they only shot themselves in the foot, both feet really, because, as a result, more people watched my film and saw that it is far more credible than the BBC's hit piece. Professor Ridley Duff did a very scholarly comparison between my film and the BBC's and came to the same conclusion. Tony Farrell, who was South Yorkshire Police's principal intelligence analyst for 12 years, also agreed with me, for which he was naturally sacked because of cowardly institutionalized denial and cognitive dissonance. Because I refused to play ball with the BBC and recount on what I had said in my film, the government decided to hit me with the bat, the bar, actually, and I was maliciously charged, arrested and extradited to the UK on a false, malicious and politically motivated charge of doing an act tending and intended to pervert the course of public justice. The investigation called Operation Favilla, the forensics, the extradition, my incarceration and trial must have wasted hundreds of thousands of pounds of your taxes. They don't care how much money they waste because it is your money they are wasting, not their own. They make a fortune and all profit from wasting your money because the courts and police are registered companies trading for profit at your expense. That is an obvious conflict of interest that they hide from the public, to whom they sell justice, contrary to their own Magna Carta of 1215 AD, Article 40. Article 40. To no one will we sell, to no one will we refuse or delay right or justice. They have turned justice into a very lucrative business that only the rich can afford. Justice has to be free, or there is no justice. If it costs even one penny, there is always someone who doesn't have a penny and thus is denied justice. As Martin Luther King said, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. If you see, read or hear of injustice, you must react immediately as though it was being done to you personally and do everything you possibly can to correct the injustice that is being done. You owe that to Christ, who taught you, "Whatsoever you do to any man, you do it to me." And the second great commandment, "Thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself." He also commanded you to love one another as he loves you, and he was willing to give his life for you. What are you willing to do? The reality is that what I did was perfectly lawful and called an amicus curiae brief, whereby anyone who is not a party to a trial, but has information or evidence that they consider relevant to the trial, can send it to the court. That's perfectly lawful and is what I did. It was also the perfect opportunity for me to officially bring the evidence I had to the attention of the judiciary, in the hope that they would order an investigation into who really carried out the bombings. So, I sent copies of my film to the court, where the government was desperately trying to frame three friends of the four alleged bombers. The judge misdirected the jury during jury selection, saying, "As you know, Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, Shehzad Tanweer, Jermaine Lindsay and Hasib Hussain were responsible for causing a series of explosions on the London Underground and public transport system on July 7, 2005 that killed 52 people and injured hundreds of others. Then, on the first day of their three friends' trial, the prosecutor lied to the jury, telling them that there was no doubt or dispute that Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, Shehzad Tanweer, Jermaine Lindsay and Hasib Hussain carried out the attacks of 7/7. You will, I'm sure, immediately recognize the names Mohammed Siddiqui Khan, Shehzad Tanweer, Jermaine Lindsay and Hasib Hussain. They are, of course, the men who, on the 7th of July 2005, detonated four bombs on the London transport network, killing not only themselves, together with 52 innocent civilians, but also injuring many hundreds of others who were unfortunate enough to be caught within the range of their bombs. During their retrial, it was reported that Neil Flewitt QC told a jury at Kingston Crown Court that there was no dispute that Khan, Tanweer, Lindsay and Hussain were responsible for the appalling act of terrorism on July 7, 2005. It was not me, but them who were guilty of trying to pervert the course of justice by misleading and lying to the jury and keeping the truth from them, because they were desperate to convict these three young men, so that they could then use their propaganda mainstream media organs to tell the public that they were guilty, and so, by extension, so were the four alleged bombers, and that my film was wrong. They failed miserably in their despicable efforts. The three were found unanimously not guilty, and my film stands as being the truth. In fact, having the evidence that I had, if I had not sent it to the court, I would have been guilty of withholding evidence and misprision of treason. The judge and prosecutor should both be charged with attempting to pervert the course of justice and perjury for lying to the jury. The three friends of the four alleged bombers spent 2 years in prison for something they could not possibly have done, because it is impossible for three men to be guilty of helping four other men do something that those four other men did not do. If the government had managed to convict them, they could have got 20 to 30 years or more in prison for something they could not possibly have done. With all the evidence I had, I absolutely could not sit back and allow that to happen. During my 157 days of false imprisonment, most of it in Wandsworth Prison, the authorities were supposed to take me to court on 5 scheduled occasions for me to apply for bail, but they didn't do so. The first time, their excuse was that they couldn't find me in their prison, which is ludicrous, because every cell has the prisoner's name and number on the outside of the door, and it's all registered on their computers. However, at 8 o'clock the very next morning, the cell door opened and they managed to find me to take me for what they claimed was a random drugs test. They could find me for a non-mandatory drugs test, but not take me to a scheduled court hearing that they were mandated to do. Fishy? It gets worse, because they didn't take me when scheduled four more times, until a nice judge got angry and ordered them to bring me the very next morning. The next morning, they finally brought me to court for my bail hearing, and the judge granted me bail. But it was 3 days after the sham inquest had finished. So, they succeeded in their evil plot of keeping me and the truth out of their sham inquest. They were absolutely terrified that I might be able to meet survivors and families of the deceased and give them copies of 7-7 Ripple Effect and tell them the truth about what really happened to them and their loved ones. You can help me to bring the real perpetrators to justice by finding the survivors and families of the deceased and telling them to watch 7-7 Ripple Effect, this film, and contact me at muadib@jforjustice.net. Eventually, my court hearing in Southwark Crown Court came, and in my defence, I challenged the jurisdiction and sovereignty of the Crown, and thus the Crown's authority to take me, or anyone, to court for victimless so-called offences, where they steal your money by fraud and or falsely imprison you. Challenging the Crown's jurisdiction also challenges the judge's own jurisdiction, because he gets his jurisdiction from the Crown. The evil, biased judge refused to let me summon Mrs. Elizabeth A.M. Battenberg Mountbatten, also known by the criminal aliases Windsor and QE2, so that I could question her about her criminality, remove her from the throne that she is fraudulently sitting upon, and redistribute her and her cronies' obscene wealth back to the British people that she and they have stolen it from, and have also enslaved and impoverished. His refusal to let me do that perverted the course of justice, was an act of treason, and proved that he was prejudiced and not impartial, and also a criminal servant of that monstrous criminal who is pretending to be the lawful monarch. He then further perverted the course of justice by deviously ignoring the absolutely irrefutable facts in my challenge that only an impartial jury can decide upon, and he refused to let the challenge go before a jury. He then committed treason again and unlawfully decided himself that the Crown, and thus he, had the right to put me on trial. It is a legal maxim that no man can judge in his own cause or in a cause to which he is a party, and I pointed that out to him, but he ignored it and decided himself that he had jurisdiction. As expected, because it was a frivolous, malicious, and politically motivated prosecution that never had any prospect of success, I was found not guilty. The evil policeman, D.S. Stephen Walker of SO15, who brought the malicious, politically motivated charges against me, the evil prosecutor, Annabel Darlow, QC, and corrupt evil judge Jeffrey Vincent Pegden, not the same judge who gave me bail, did everything they could to try to persuade the jury to convict me, but they weren't having any of it. The jury watched 7-7 Ripple Effect and heard me give testimony, and they understood that what I had done was intended to stop the authorities from perverting the course of justice and prevent a miscarriage of justice in the trial of those three young men who were on trial at Kingston, and that it was absolutely the right thing to do. The challenge document is available online for you to use, and it can be downloaded at jforjustice.net/challenge or jforjustice.net/e2go.html and can and should be used by everyone who is charged with a victimless, fraudulent, legislated offence. If everyone does that in every court in the land, even if they try to ignore it, they will be being put on notice. When everyone knows, and they know that everyone knows, then their evil system will collapse and set everyone free from their evil thieving clutches. What you need to do to use it is download it from the link above. Change the word you at the top to your name, then sign and date it at the bottom. And, along with the two exhibits that are also downloadable at the same site, file it with the court that has summoned you and give a copy to the prosecutor as well. Then they, the hierarchy enslaving you, will know that you know they are operating fraudulently and, in order to prevent the public from finding out, they will probably drop the charges. If they don't, then you will need to argue the case in court by challenging the Crown and thus the judge's jurisdiction publicly. You can get advice on this, if you need it, from jforjustice.net. When enough people are made aware of their fraud and they know that everyone knows, they will have to stop and return to God's perfect royal law of liberty that you were given by God through Moses at Sinai to protect you from evil, instead of living under their fraudulent oppressive legislation. Every British monarch swears at their coronation to maintain the laws of God to the utmost of his or her power, and then does not do so, because they want to maintain their unlawful legislation under which they enrich themselves at your expense. The last page of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 4, warns you what will happen to you if you don't. The choice is yours. God's royal perfect laws of liberty are in the Old Testament's first five books, the books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Learn and enforce them to set yourselves free from poverty and oppression and share in the redistribution of the monarch's and her cronies' fraudulently stolen riches. The law the monarch swears to maintain to the utmost of his or her power forbids him or her from using their position for personal gain of any kind and enriching themselves at the expense of others, thereby driving them into debt slavery. The Saudis and other Arab so-called royalty do not want Muslims to read the Bible and keep the covenant, because under the covenant law just quoted, they too would have to give up and redistribute their obscene wealth. So they have told Muslims that the true Bible no longer exists, which is a lie, attested to by God in the Holy Quran, the Gospel of Unity. Surah 32, Ayat 23. We did indeed aforetime give the book, the Torah, the law, to Moses. Be then not in doubt of its, the Torah, reaching thee. We made it a guide to the children of Israel. Further proof from the Holy Quran, the Gospel of Unity states, Surah 3, Ayat 64, say, O people of the book, the Bible, come to common terms as between us and you, that we worship none but God, that we associate no partners with him, that we erect not from amongst ourselves lords or kings or queens and patrons other than God. If then they turn back, say ye, bear witness that we at least are true in faith, bowing to God's will. So how then can there be Muslim emirs or kings, etc.? I have correctly translated and interpreted the Holy Bible and Quran, also known as the Gospel of Unity, and combined them into the one book that the ruler of the universe always intended them to be, the King of Kings Bible. jartruth.net/kofkad.htm and have added explanatory notes and cross-referenced them with each other to show everyone that there is no reason to fight religious wars, but to unite as one brotherhood, reading all of the book and living by only his laws in peace and prosperity. Long live the fighters, for God, good, Allah, Muad'Dib. P.S. Now please watch the following. E2 Go Ripple Effect and E2 Not Wanting Publicity. jforjustice.net/e2go.html. You can find much more detailed information about what happened to me and interviews I have done at the Friends of Muad'Dib website, mtrial.org. I also strongly recommend reading Terror on the Tube, Behind the Veil of 77 by Nicholas Kollerstrom, available via Amazon UK, and watching the films about 77 made by Richard D. Hall of richplanet.net. I would also like to thank Nicholas and Richard for visiting me in Wandsworth Prison, and Richard for all his help by making his films to gain support for me and giving me permission to use footage from his films for this DVD.